you know, we all believe in our own theories, and you're doing a great job, David, and we thank you for these efforts here. My name's the medium for light is flowing downward into the cores of gravitating bodies. I came to that conclusion in the 1990s. I resisted it for a while because I thought that would mean that at least some of the terrestrial bodies, the moon and moons and planets, would have to expand because of it, and didn't even know that there was even a theory or that was even a possibility, so I kept on rejecting it. But that seemed like the only explanation to explain the various speed of light experiments, whether Michelson-Morley or Sagnac, etc. I then discovered expanding your theory, and I was trying to figure out a way to write papers for mainstream journals to sort of break into mainstream science that was somewhat revolutionary, but that had a chance of getting published. I knew that was not possible in physics. I thought expanding your theory was the way to go, and I thought specifically it was biogeography. Biogeography is the is really the subject of revolutionaries, and it's the subject of why plants and animals are where they are. It's what led Darwin to the theory of evolution, led Wegener to the theory of continental drift. It's the basis of guns, germs, and steel, and a lot of mavericks go into it. So I thought that the type of people that were in it might be willing to accept papers on the subject. So I've had some mainstream papers. I was fortunate enough to have some mainstream papers published on the subject. Here are a few of them specifically relating to expanding your theory. This one is the Journal of Geophysical Research. It has a video attached. And although it doesn't mention expanding Earth, it really is an expanding Earth paper, but I'll get to more of that later. The important subject is biogeography. I've got a book coming out on it. This is a shameless plug. It's coming out on, in October, so you know, it'll make a good Christmas present. Get your wallets out. But it's on biogeography, very significant subject to the history of revolutions, and Detroit and Wegener both used it as, this is really what convinced them of the fact that continents were once together. It is the seminal theory that led them to continental drift. And as you can see, not only do the continents fit together, this is Gondwana, which, by the way, is named after a region where Glossopteris fossils, this is a fossil plant, like a fern tree, Glossopteris fossils are found in India. And Gondwana is the region where they're found. It shows that the entire concept of Gondwana, with all the continents together, resisted by geologists, resisted by geophysicists, and for decades and decades, and despite what Dutoy and Wegener were arguing. But as you can see here, it's not only that the continents fit together, it's that the fossils of the species are located in regions that match. So it's not, it's like puzzle pieces. So if you imagine that the species are like the colors or the patterns on the puzzle pieces, it's not just the geometrical shapes, it's the actual species, because they've got to get from one place to the other. They can't cross oceans. We know the plants and animals that can cross oceans. So therefore, this is strong and powerful evidence that led to it. Geophysicists denied it for decades, but this is where the evidence really lies, and this is where I've been focusing on. Say they closed the Atlantic here, they closed the Indian Ocean here. And as we'll show, as I will hope to show and hope to prove to everyone here, necessarily the Pacific was closed as well at the same time frame, requiring a smaller Earth at that time. Okay, expanding Earth. This is the other theory of continental drift. Otto Hilgenberg started in the 19th century, but Otto Hilgenberg was really the first to write a significant book on the subject. And in that book, he contended that seafloor creation between the continents as the Earth expands is the mechanism for drift. And this makes some predictions. It predicts that all seafloor must be less than 200 million years old, which is the minimum age of continental crust. Continental crust, the cratons are billions of years old, 3.5 billion to 4.5 billion years old. But as you get closer to the coast of each continent, it becomes younger and younger. A lot of the some of the coast is between 200 to 500 million years old. And then the oceans, as we shall see, are younger than that. It predicts seafloor spreading. It predicts some sort of influx of seawater, because you need something increasing the amount of the surface expression of seawater. And it predicts biotic and geological links across the Pacific, as well as Atlantic and Indian Oceans. All these predictions have been confirmed. This is the most important map that there is. This is a map of facts, not of hypotheses, not like the drawings that you see in plate tectonics, conjectures of paleo maps. This is actually a map of facts. This is a map of crustal ages. If you notice, all seafloor crust is less than 200 million years old. 180 million years old is the dark blue. You see some in the Pacific and the Atlantic and the Indian. But yellow is about 67 million years old. The South Pacific is a very juvenile barrier, most of it less than 40 million years old. That will become important later on. Some of the arguments that we see for the Atlantic, which is the matching outlines, we also see in the Pacific. They're matching outlines across the Pacific. Now, the crust is very young in between these ancient regions. And if you remove the juvenile Pacific crust, the matching geological outlines are rejoined, as in the Atlantic. Here, for example, if you notice the curl of South America at Tierra del Fuego, it matches the curl at the edge of the Australasian plate. You bring them together, the match is identical in size and shape. If you notice, the fit runs from the North Pacific to the South Pacific. And the match is uncanny. But here's the question. There are plants and animals on opposite sides of the Pacific that are closely related, or fossils that are identical species. They're called problematic trans-Pacific disjunct taxa being plants and animals, disjunct because they're separated. They're on opposite sides of the Pacific. You've got only a few ways of explaining that. Full ocean jump dispersal across the Pacific, and these are poor dispersing taxa. It's never been known before to occur. Or it's possible complete range expansion when there's Pangaea from one side of Pangaea to the other with no fossil evidence. Or are some distributions the result of the recent formation of the Pacific Ocean? Did the Pacific Ocean form between them? Now, we know which plants and animals can cross major oceanic barriers. This is an example of a tremendous dispersalist. This is tetragnathus the spiders, or long-jawed orb weavers. They actually send out little silk threads in a process called ballooning, and the little silk threads from their abdomens carry them high into the atmosphere, and they can float. They usually float to the other side of a field or a forest, but sometimes they go higher and higher. They float for hundreds of miles, sometimes they float for thousands, and this takes them everywhere. They usually start from East Asia and they go all across the Pacific. They've ended up on every oceanic island, but this is an example of an amazing disperser. Same thing with ferns, which have reproduced through spores. They also float and are carried by the wind. There are all sorts of taxa, and we know by how they reproduce, how they move, whether they can cross oceans or not. And the exact opposite of these long-distance dispersers we get with some of the problematic disjuncts. These taxa are found on opposite sides of the Pacific, in which you've got one, for example, in New Zealand. New Zealand matches with southern South America. You'll find a lot of taxa that are similar in both regions. The Tuatara, which is biophysically limited because it's a vertebrae. All vertebrates are all reptiles, mammals, amphibians particularly, are extremely biophysically limited. They really can't get to the remoter oceanic islands, let alone cross the full extent of an ocean. They have a narrow range. They're only found in New Zealand, and their closest relatives went extinct in the late Cretaceous in South America. They're not found en route. They're not found anywhere in between. They don't occur on any other oceanic island group. There are countless taxa, hundreds of taxa like this. I'm just showing you a few others. The flat oyster, also New Zealand, also links up with southern South America, with Chile. Its closest relatives are in Chile, and they're found nowhere else, and they can't even cross Cook Strait between North Island and South Island of New Zealand. They're so sedentary. They're found at the bottom of the sea, but they can't cross the ocean because the ocean is very deep regions. They would be crushed and dead at the bottom of the ocean. They have to stick to very shallow regions near continental regions, New Zealand and South America. Another example is the New Caledonia's flightless kagu, which is most closely related to the sun bittern of South America, of tropical South America, which is weakly flying. Picture Turkey. We could get a few hundred yards. No way it could fly 10 kilometers, let alone 100, let alone 8,000. The banded iguana of Fiji. Iguanas are neotropical, the South American taxon, and there's one group of iguanas in the West Pacific, and it's on Fiji, and they're found nowhere else. They're not in Australia, they're not in East Asia, they're not on any other oceanic island in the West Pacific. And it's 8,000 kilometers away. This is not feasible for the iguana to have gotten there, given conventional paleo maps. All right, next. We have also, same thing with the Lulligenid squids. All are biophysically limited. This is links up. This is from the Caribbean. It appears in the Caribbean and appears on in the West Pacific as well. Now, people who want to maintain their faith in conventional paleo maps have to argue that these taxa made these, and the hundreds of others that I'm not mentioning, have made these extraordinary jaunts, these extreme movements from one side of the Pacific to the other. But the fact of the matter is, we know the difference between what taxa can cross the ocean and what taxa can't. The spiders, the tetragnathic spiders that I mentioned before, obviously have all the abilities have all the evidence for their ability to cross oceans, but the Fiji, like the banded iguana, does not, nor do any of the taxa I mentioned. And if you're ignoring this, you're disregarding all biogeographical evidence. I mean, it doesn't matter. If you don't care whether the fact that the iguana is not biophysically adapted for extreme dispersal, it's got a narrow range, it means it's only found on Fiji and the other island of Fiji, Vanuatu. It's not found on Rude, it's not paraphyletic, it does not occur on other oceanic islands. If you don't take that as evidence, then there's no evidence against these extreme dispersal hypotheses. But they still have the following difficulties: the wide-ranging problem, the Du Toit-Wegener argument, and the ancient island problem. The wide-ranging problem is very simple. If these taxa could have crossed the full extent of an ocean, then they're likely to be wide-ranging, likely to appear on many other oceanic islands. This is what most other taxa that have managed to cross significant gaps, they appear in a lot of different locations. For example, Pitcairn Islands, that's where Fletcher Christian went after he mutinied on the Bounty. The juvenile Pitcairn group is halfway between New Zealand and South America. every one of its 114 species of flora are descended from great dispersing, wide-ranging ancestors that appear on other oceanic islands. There are no terrestrial vertebrates on Pitcairn, and it's completely populated by great dispersing taxa, which are wide-ranging. Pitcairn does not exclusively share any plant with South America. In other words, every plant that does share with South America that has made it from South America to Pitcairn, which is in the middle of the Pacific, has also managed to move to other islands around the Pacific, because if it can reach Pitcairn, it can reach places significantly closer. Now, this is unlike New Zealand, in which South America shares all sorts of taxa with it, in which they're found nowhere else on the planet. All right. And the other problem is, no one has referenced a single counterexample ever of a narrow-range poor disperser from a remote juvenile oceanic island from a place where vicariants can be excluded. Vicariance being a geological explanation for the distribution rather than the fact that dispersal had to occur. The oceanic islands, almost all oceanic islands that are not continental in origin, are young. They've risen up from the ocean floor and formed in the middle of the ocean. So every creature that has to get there has to get there through dispersal. There's no other explanation for it. The Detroit-Wagner argument, I touched upon this earlier. This is taught to elementary school students around the world. Repeated narrow-range transoceanic distributional patterns of poor dispersers are evidence of vicariance. This is obvious. Vicariance meaning that it's a geological event that is the reason for the disjunctions, for the reason for the separation. They were together at one point, but some geological event, in this case, the continents broke up, is the reason why the fossils are now separated. That's what vicariance means. The only other explanation is dispersal. Clearly, these taxa did not cross the ocean. Here are some of the trans-Pacific disjuncts. Everyone agrees, if you look on the right side of the screen, everyone agrees that the transatlantic and trans-Indian disjunctions of these taxa is the result of vicariance, is the result of a closed Atlantic Ocean, is the result of a closed Indian Ocean, is the result of the fact that Gondwana was together. They agree that these creatures on the right side of the screen can't cross oceans, and so the fact that they're found on opposite sides of the Atlantic and opposite sides of the Indian Ocean necessarily means that those oceans were closed. Well, on the left side of the screen are the trans-Pacific disjuncts. They're the same type of taxa from the same time frame. It's the same argument. If you say the ones on the right side of the screen suggest that the Atlantic and Indian Oceans were closed, then the ones on the left side suggest that the Pacific was closed. It's that simple. These taxa are mostly, by the way, East Asia, China, and North America, Western North America. Here's a conventional paleo map of the Upper Triassic. Here's the colored regions that note transoceanic disjunction of poor dispersing fossil taxa. So we find fossil taxa that are similar in the regions of similar colors. So the blues are put together. Wagner got that right. The greens are put together. Wagner got that right. He was right that these taxa had suggested that the Atlantic was closed, and you bring them together, and they come together. But here's the problem. You also have similar fossil taxa in these red regions, Western North America and East Asia, and then this yellow region right here in Australia and South America. This suggests that rather than just continents and one side of an Earth and this now vanished Pantalassa super ocean on the other side, instead these regions were together. Okay. Here's a polar view of it. I mean, they're literally on opposite sides of the globe. It's really absurd. It really is absurd. And as I'm about to show, people are now starting to accept the fact that it's absurd. They're starting to accept, and these are mainstream scientists and mainstream journals, are now starting to accept that the paleo maps are wrong. And I will show that a little later on. Examples of Upper Triassic, Lower Jurassic, biotic links between East Asia and Western North America. East Asia shares more tetrapod families. This is, at this time, this is just before the dinosaurs. Tetrapods are just four-legged creatures. They're reptilian-like creatures, like Cynognathus and Lysosaurus, which I showed you earlier. East Asia shares more tetrapod families with Western North America than any other region. East Asia and Western North America have very high index of similarity for tetrapods, which means if you determine all the number of, you consider the percentage of tetrapods that they share with each other, it's very high. It's higher than East Asia, Russia, or East Asia, Europe, and precisely the same as South America, South Africa, which everyone agrees is evidence that South America and South Africa were together. East Asia, Western North America, and Australia, South America, and also share a great number of plants, insects, freshwater, and marine taxa. And again, if this evidence indicates vicariance, if this evidence indicates the Atlantic was closed and the Indian Ocean was closed, of course, it also suggests the Pacific was closed as well. The only way to explain these distributions, it's absolutely absurd. You'd have to have Trans-Panthalassa Island seamount hopping, and they really do argue this, and they argue the rest is Pangean range expansion with no fossil evidence. So they have to be here, and they have to be all throughout Europe and all throughout Central Asia, and just their fossils have never been discovered anywhere, and then again in East Asia. Here's a zipper effect on expanding a paleo map, matching outlines, and matching taxa. It's just like with the Atlantic and the Indian Oceans, and these are just a handful of the taxa that are together. The places, the outlines match, and the taxa match. And I've got to go to another document. The ancient island problem is another major problem that they have. There are more than 25,000 islands in the Pacific, but only three island groups are ancient enough to be candidates for vicariance. That means to where that they were actually in a different location near continents to where they could have actually taken, to where the explanation is because of a reduced marine gap or because of a juxtaposition of the islands with the continents. And these are New Zealand, New Caledonia, and Fiji. These are the oldest islands in the Pacific. New Zealand and New Caledonia are continental. They're literally hundreds, if not, I believe New Zealand is more than a billion years old, but they're hundreds of millions of years old. Fiji is the oldest oceanic island in the world. It's an oceanic island complex. It's at least 50 million years old, at least 50. It's part of an arc system that was also, all the other oceanic islands are necessarily juvenile and have necessarily formed in the middle of an ocean. And every miraculous narrow-range trans-Pacific island disjunction, every one that biogeographers are arguing about, the only thing that is a problem for biogeography occurs on those three islands. The other disjuncts, or they occur on continental regions like Australia, New Guinea, Indonesia, and East Asia. They don't occur on regular oceanic islands. There are no miraculous jaunts to regular oceanic islands. Hawaii, for example, as with, say, the Cook Islands and Pitcairn, has no native terrestrial vertebrates. That's no native non-volant, that means non-flying mammals, no native reptiles, no native amphibians. None of the juvenile 25,000 islands boast cross-ocean, greater than 3,000 kilometer, jaunts of narrow-range poor dispersers. Everything that's on Hawaii today that has four legs is the result of human introduction, whether by Polynesians or Europeans after Polynesians settled there, without exception. And the reason is because it's in the middle of the Pacific and vertebrates drown. They can't get that far into the middle of the ocean. It takes months and months and months on a raft. It would, if you could do it. And of course, you know, that's just not going to occur. They're going to die of thirst. They're going to die of starvation. And there's stormy weather and everything. It's just not possible. It's not feasible. Now this brings me to a very interesting study recently by Gonzalo Jarabe. He's a Harvard invertebrate biologist, and he sent me this paper in which it was 10 years, or well, 5 to 6 years in the making, in which he found the perfect, taxon for biogeographical study. I'm just going to read what I've written about this because it's a very interesting story. He first tried to figure out which creature he should study that would actually give him the most evidence about where continents were in the past. It's a colossal and painstaking global-scale examination of mite harvestmen, which is a short-legged arachnid with a tiny body the size of a grain of rice, and it's a relative of the more familiar daddy long legs. He realized that for another reason, the mite harvestmen just may be the quintessential biogeographical taxon. First, they're incredibly ancient. The oldest of the old, arachnids are among the first creatures to have walked on land, and these mite harvestmen are among the oldest tribes within arachnids. The group most closely related to these mite harvestmen is known to have existed 400 million years ago, more than 150 million years before the dinosaurs, even before the first fish crawled out of the water. Second, the dirt-dwelling mite harvestmen are notoriously poor dispersers. They occur only on continental fragments, absent from all volcanic oceanic islands. They consist of nearly 150 named species, and they are so sedentary, so completely inept at getting around, that the minor ecological barriers that we may find over very short distances are enough to isolate populations of these arachnids for many millions of years. Typically, each species has a range of less than 80 kilometers. Finally, and this is another important thing that Jarabe was looking for, they're everywhere. They're absolutely everywhere. They occur on every continent except Antarctica. But unlike other plants and animals with such an extended range, these tiny arachnids did not reach their current residence through fantastic and expansive jaunts. Instead, they crawled inch by inch. The prodigious extent of the distribution is not due to their travel ideal of distributional studies. So now he spent 6 years traveling every continent except Antarctica, grabbing these mite harvestmen, searching them, and then extracted their DNA to determine their relationships. And this map is what he discovered. Now, as you can see, it exactly matches the Pangean concept, except with one major exception. If you can see the colors of it, the yellows are all closely related to each other. Japan matches with Western North America. That matches. There are spiders in between these regions, but he didn't need to do it because he knows that they're all going to be of the same type of family. Notice the green right here. This family of spiders links together. They're not spiders. They're harvestmen, but they're close to spiders. Links together with that in Africa. That's because that shows that Africa was close together. Notice the red at the bottom. They're all part of the same family. They're all closely related, and that's because India was part of Gondwana. It came down. It all came together into Gondwana. But here's the thing. Again, the ones in the Neotropics match with New Caledonia, and this is simply not easy to explain at all. He was looking specifically for something which would tell him where continents used to be, and again he matches New Caledonia with South America. And as I say, New Caledonia really should be called Old Ecuador. You can look at it this way. all these texts are ancient texts that I've been discussing, all of the, that I've been describing, all the problematic disjuncts involve ancient taxa, and all the regions. To move around the Pacific. This image is terrible, but I'll leave Neil Adams to work the images. Here's another great argument for a smaller and closed Pacific in the Triassic and a smaller Pacific in the Cretaceous is the dinosaur circuit. Again, this is not a great graphic, but it gives you an idea. Dinosaurs had to move in between North America and South America. That's actually conventional, the American bridge. All four bridges, Bering Bridge, Antarctic Bridge, Australasian Bridge, are needed for dinosaurs to get from one place to the other. We find, let's do the thing. The Australasian Bridge, which is from Australia to Asia. You've got carnosaurs, protoceratopsians, overrapetosaurus, dromaeosaurs, ankylosaurs, varanid lizards, I don't want a freshwater fish, helicoid land snails. American Bridge, you have hadrosaurs as well. So the dinosaurs are moving all the way around the Pacific. That's not possible if the Pacific is the same size it is today, let alone significantly larger, because the continents can't, there's not enough continental material to surround the Pacific. But all these at the same time were moving between these regions. This was actually a subject in one of my papers. It's just, it's inarguable. Let's keep it going. So why do some believe in extreme dispersal? It's faith in conventional paleomaps, faith in conventional paleomaps, faith in conventional paleomaps. But they also, these paleomaps have also more than just biogeographical problems. Here's a view. Okay, can we see this? All right. Here's a view from, this is a conventional view of the Pacific Basin, the late Cretaceous. Colored, comma-shaped oceanic crust marks the Pacific Plate. This is the Pacific Plate. This is all that is known to exist. This is all that exists today. Everything else, all this white stuff is hypothetical. It's just there because they believe that the Earth has always been its current size, and you need this missing space. And this is what they fill up with hypothetical. Depicts hypothetical ancient ocean crust that's now been completely allegedly subducted. What are some of the problems? One, the Detroit Seamount, which is at the top of the Pacific Plate, was north of Japan. We know this from paleomagnetic data and Western North America. And was at the same latitude with Kamchatka, which is number three, and the Aleutians. We know this from paleomagnetic data. Geological and biogeographical analysis, as I've shown earlier, can have no marine gap between these regions at all, and all this suggests the continents tightly surrounded the Pacific Plate. Another 40 million years ago, you have terrestrial sediments of the zodiac fan. Fans are the result of rivers taking continental sediments and putting them into the ocean. And you've got a terrestrial fan right there at the top of the Pacific Plate that's 40 million years old. And you need a continental source to produce it. And it's now placed into the middle of the ocean, and actually it's got to be next to Alaska with the rivers creating the that fan. And there's another thing. Notice the comma shape, this comma-like shape of the Pacific Plate. The comma-shaped Pacific Plate continues to move northwest, expanding the east to fill up the ocean basin. And now you've got the comma-shaped outlines. These are outlines of trenches and continents, which also gives the comma shape. Obviously, The Pacific formed in situ. It formed there, and the formation of the conus-shaped Pacific plate created the conus-shaped outline that surrounds it, just as it did in the Indian Ocean, in which the outlines of the spreading ridges is what carved and pushed apart the continents. The same thing occurred in the Pacific. The conus-shaped Pacific plate matches the conus-shaped West Pacific continental outlines. All right. Top 10 reasons Pacific plate formed in situ, pushing continents apart. 10. I don't really get into this here, but trans-Pacific tethys continents exhibit geological ties. This is actually well accepted. Osmex and Sidecore are different theories of Rodinia, which actually place like Australia next to northern northeastern Australia next to western Mexico, southwestern Mexico. That's Osmex. Siberia is next to North America. Australia is hooked to East Asia, India to South Asia. All these continents exhibit geological ties, and it's now accepted. And so they place them together in the Paleozoic. That's why they have to create an entirely new a supercontinent in order to explain the geological ties that they can't explain with Pangaea. GPS confirms separation of Australia, South America, and not enough trench convergence. So that Australia and South America are continuously separating today, and there's enough trench convergence to overcome that. Paleomagnetic data require a little to know latitudinal motion of the Pacific plate with respect to surrounding continents. I just described that. The Eocene zodiac fan requires juxtaposition with Alaska. I described that. Cretaceous Pacific plate fits north to south in the available Cretaceous Pacific basin. No pre-Jurassic seafloor exists today. What a coincidence. The trans-Pacific continental outlines match, and Pacific isochrones run parallel with the neighboring continental trench outlines and match the conus shape. The late Cretaceous dinosaur circuit, and these are the big ones, requires terrestrial connections around the Pacific. There's no way you can get around that. And run the repeated pattern trans-Pacific tethys disjunctions of poor dispersers, I believe, to be the number one reason. The reason people fight a close Pacific, because it would imply Earth expansion. Although we do not have a workable model for planetary formation, everyone apparently knows that planets and moons must have expanded quickly through accretion during formation of billions of years ago and have not expanded since. That's what everyone believes. Yet, we have now discovered that Ganymede has experienced significant post-formation expansion. Riftings and surface rejuvenation are so prevalent on Ganymede that mainstream scientists have now accepted that it has expanded significantly, as much as 10% in size. And it's actually expanded larger, but they can't explain it, so they're slowly accepting it. 200 million years ago, 80 million years ago, 40 million years ago, today. I got one more group of slides, and just to carry it out. And this will be the conclusion. What is important here is that this is really a scientific revolution that is occurring right now. Mainstream scientists from around the world are now accepting this, particularly biogeographers, people who work in the field, biologists, paleontologists, are now accepting that the paleomaps that geophysicists are giving them are wrong. And they're saying this in mainstream journal articles, and they're now starting to accept the possibility of a closed Pacific. And this is really what a scientific revolution looks like, in which you get more and more papers on it. There are right now far more papers advocating expanding Earth theory in mainstream journals than I think any other dissident theory, by the way, in any field of science, or certainly more than any paper on continental drift got into mainstream journals in, say, the 20s and 30s and 40s and 50s. this is seriously, it's reaching critical mass. More and more serious scientists are accepting it, and they're starting to realize that the conventional paleo maps are wrong. They have to Glaspie, now he's an expanding earther, but he analyzed distributions of freshwater worm, found multiple, and these are just, these are all mainstream papers that I'm going to go through, quickly. Found multiple tropical and trans-southern Pacific disjunctions, conclusion vicariance, by which I mean there's got to be a geological explanation for it. They couldn't have dispersed there. And when I ask at the bottom, was this really a false positive? Is he being misled by evidence? Is he's doing an analysis? His analysis comes up with vicariance, that it can't be dispersal, that it's got to be a geological event, i.e. the closing of the Pacific. And was this a false positive? Is he being misled by the evidence? And Hads and Green analyzed distributions of compositae, multiple pattern disjunctions linking New Zealand and southern Chile and New Guinea and California. They conclude vicariance. Was this a false positive? Ager, he's a major scientist, extremely well respected. He analyzed distributions. This is in 88 of early Mesozoic brachiopods. Found multiple links between Western Americas and East Asia. In fact, he found links across all the oceans. He concluded that the oceans had to be closed. Was this a false positive? He gave a great quote in the paper. This is the paper was a paper in Modern Geology, but it also was his presidential address for the British Association of the Advancement of Science. And you know, I find it difficult to accept different explanations for the same phenomena which occurred in the various great oceans of the Earth. On the balance, I prefer to think that all the oceans have been expanding since early Mesozoic times, and that therefore the hypothesis of an expanding Earth is inescapable. He also said, and this is a wonderful quote, "I'm not deterred by geophysicists telling me that expanding Earth is impossible. I've heard that sort of story before from the geophysicist." Mateo, he worked with, is probably the most renowned expert, was at the time, of keroplatid flies. Found multiple links between tropical Americas and Southeast Asia, Australasia, New Caledonia. He was a renowned biologist all his life. He couldn't explain this, and he came to expanding Earth theory very late in life. And that's his image. One of many. He had many distributions like that. But it just shows you what that looks like on Pangaea, the image right here, how disjunct they are on, you know, they end up on opposite sides of the supercontinent with Pangaea, and they're all next to each other with in the expanding Earth model. Shields analyzed Upper Triassic, flora insects, and freshwater fish, multiple links between southwestern North America and China, but and between Queensland and Central South America. Again, conclusion vicariance. He's an expanding earther as well, but this is a mainstream journal article. But here, Voyager Bay, they're not expanding earthers. They weren't that, but they still found this. They sent this to me, Gerbet did, saying, you know, how do you explain this? And this just matches with all of the other New Caledonia taxa that link with Southern South America. And there have been more and more articles like this with people who can't understand why the distributions aren't matching up with the paleo maps. Here's another one. Schwenger, who was part of that, who was part of the Gerbet group who did the thing on the mite, did the analysis on the mite harvestmen, he analyzed trapdoor spiders, which are ground dwelling, they're burrowing spiders. They've got no chance of major dispersal. Of major cross-ocean dispersal, they dig holes in the ground, and the ones from Thailand are most closely related to spiders from Mexico and Guatemala. As Schrodinger wrote, the opening of the Pacific Ocean and subsequent separation of East and Southeast Asia from North America and the Jurassic would better explain this distribution. Finally, I've got other ones. I can just keep going about this. There's dozens of recent papers over the last, say, 5-6 years in biogeography which suggest that there's a problem with paleo maps, or come right out and say there was no significant marine gap between these regions. And this is really a big one, in which Jay Hilton and Christopher Cleal conducted three biogeographical analyses of fossil flora from China and America, and they found that the plant communities in both places are so similar that they're part of the same floral province. And they wants to even change the name. They used to call it Cathasian and American or Euro-American. And he wanted to change the name to just Amerocinian, in other words, American Chinese, just a floral province. This is an entire plant community. This is groups of species and that are similar or identical to ones found in Western North America and China. Of course, the only explanation with paleo maps is that they dispersed there, and they wrote, it is hard to consider this as a suitable explanation for the transport of an entire wetland plant community from Euro-America to the China, from the Euro-America to the North China block. I mean, if you look at it, let's go one more. If you look at it, again, East Asia and Western North America are not in view. The floral provinces, this identical floral province, are on opposite sides of the globe. Worse, there's another floral province, which exists between them, the Angara floral province, which is made up of different plants, completely different plants. So you've got identical ones separated in the middle it's just not conceivable. So is this a coincidence? All these things. How to explain all of these problems that I've gone through? Scientists are realizing you can't. How do you explain such fossil similarity of marine and terrestrial taxa on opposite sides of the globes? They're realizing it's not possible. And the simple fact is, the vanished Panthalassa hypothesis, Panthalassa being the super ocean that allegedly filled out the other side of the hemisphere, it just didn't exist. It fails paleomagnetic, sedimentary, geological, and most importantly, biogeographical analyses. And I was going to go into this. People, one of the biggest stumbling blocks on expanding Earth theory is ocean. They say, well, if the Earth was smaller, then all the seawater would totally flood all the continents, so all the seawater that exists today. Well, it assumes that there is just as much seawater then as there is now. This is an extremely dubious assumption, and it has a lot of problems. That the amount of seawater has been constant for a billion years. There are a few problems with actually the conventional view of a fixed radius Earth and the origin of seawater. The questions that really bring this out are, what process filled the ocean basins with water? Well, currently, scientists believe a combination of icy comets and volcanic exhalations. Well, why did that almost precisely fill the ocean basins? And why did that process stop? In other words, why would icy comets come in, fill the ocean basins, and then stop just as the ocean basins are filled? So that, I mean, it's amazing how close that the volume of seawater matches the volume of the available ocean basins. And there's no reason that any of these processes should have stopped. Volcanoes are still exhaling water vapor, and icy comets are still hitting the atmosphere. What's the cause of the steady lowering of sea levels over the last 80 million years? They really can't explain that. What is the cause of massive sea level fluctuations in the Mesozoic and earlier? This is at a time when, especially during ice-free times, when they can't claim the formation of glaciers at the poles locked up a lot of the water and pounded a lot of the water, and so lowered sea levels, they can't claim that. And these questions are answerable only by expanding Earth theory. What is usually pointed out as a weakness of expanding Earth theory is actually one of its strengths, because it is explained by hydrothermal vents. Hydrothermal vent systems, their volumetric output is causally linked to C4 spreading rates. Few people point this out, but the faster there are spreading rates, and which is what gives the ocean basins its volume, its width, which is what gives the ocean basins its volume. The faster that the spreading rates occur, the faster that an ocean basin is widening, the more hydrothermal vents there are, the more that there is material upwelling from the mantle, the more water is also upwelling from the mantle. It is literally in proportion, and they flood rifting ocean basins in rough proportion to the rate of the growth of the ocean basins. And you can see that this is occurring, for example, in two rift valleys, which have giant lakes in them, which are set upon hydrothermal vents. Lake Tanganyika in Africa, which is on the Great Rift Valley, and all the lake systems, the Great Rift Valley. Same thing with Lake Baikal in Russia. They're both on rifts. They're both nascent oceans. They're both young oceans. They're oceans forming right now, because this is where the continents are breaking apart now, and these regions are going to divide, and an ocean is going to form. Well, the reason that all the fresh water, all that water is in Tanganyika, and all that water is in Baikal, they're the most voluminous lakes in the world, and by far, Baikal holds more water than all the Great Lakes combined. The reason is because they sit on hydrothermal vents, and the reason is because not only is the region breaking apart and splitting and new land is forming, but water's also coming up there. It's not just land, but water is also forming. Thus, as the continents break up, there will be more hydrothermal vents, and there will be more water coming in, and ultimately much of this water is derived from the mantle, which now holds more than five times the amount of water than is found currently in the oceans. And here's a final thing. This is a figure from my JGR paper, and this is also an interesting point. This is according to their own models. This is subduction and seafloor spreading along 25 degrees south. And in fact, they show that this is true for all latitudes south of the equator, up until like 60 degrees south. That expansion in the east-west direction is outpacing subduction. The reason is, and this is true whether you believe in expanding Earth or not. I got the paper published in JGR because I didn't mention expanding Earth, and I didn't try to suggest that the Earth was expanding, although the paper really is a closet expanding Earth paper. But what is going on is that the latitudinal bands of crust are all being pushed north, and as you move toward the equator from the south, as these latitudinal bands of crust are all heading north, they're moving to wider and wider, bigger and bigger latitudes, the bigger circumferences. The equator is the biggest latitude, and it becomes bigger. So they have to have more seafloor spreading than subduction in order to put in the necessary material to fill up the extra material needed as they're moving to larger latitudes. For example, 25 degrees south, and this is conventional. I'm not saying anything here that's for expanding Earth. This is a fact. So 25 degrees south is right now expanding at about 77 millimeters per year. And because it's moving north, it's moving to 26 degrees, and it's moving, I'm sorry, 24 degrees, 23, it's moving closer to 0 degrees, the equator. So it's expanding at 77 millimeters per year. And these are in millimeters per year. The point of it is that's how the Earth, we now know how the Earth, necessarily they have to admit, that's how the Earth compensates for expanding circumferences. This is what an expanding circumference looks like. And how does it do it? It does it with spreading ridges, which are creating more material that is being subducted. These latitudes are expanding necessarily, regardless of whether you believe in expanding Earth or not. These latitudes are expanding, and they're expanding through seafloor spreading. And so In other words, if you want to know what an expanding circumference looks like, just look at the Earth, look at the southern hemispheres, and you see these spreading ridges, and you see it outpacing subduction, and it shows that, because a lot of scientists try to claim, or a lot of try to say that this is that if the Earth were expanding, it really wouldn't look like this, it would do other things. No, it would look exactly like this. This is how circumferences expand. This is how a planet compensates for an expanding circumference. It's through C4 spreading. And the other, and so here, all of this evidence indicates an expanding Earth. Okay. And that's it, I'm done. Anyone still here? Alright, I don't...
Hear me now?
I'm here. Really gotten into that to the exact acceleration rate over time. First of all, you have to be very careful because there's a difference between constant radial expansion A constant rate of expansion would suggest a massive acceleration of expansion over time, because to expand by 1 inch, for the Earth to expand by an inch now at its current size, would require a much greater volumetric increase than it would have 80 million years ago, when, let's say, it was 85 or 80 or 75% of its current size. So the idea that it's been a steady, so I would tend to think that the radial expansion may have even